Assalamu alaikum. Unprecedented, subhanAllah, a term that you and I have become well acquainted with in recent times, because we are living through unprecedented times, brothers and sisters in Islam. We have planes grounded, we have airports shut, borders closed, schools have ceased, the children are at home, we have currencies and shares in deep dive, we have thousands getting sick daily, hundreds being buried daily, you know, job security is at an all-time low. No one knows what the future will hold, all because of an army from the armies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creating havoc across the globe. وَلَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُ. No one knows of the armies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because of this virus, the coronavirus, we have the Kaaba protected and blocked off. And recently, brothers and sisters in Islam, we have many masajid across the face of the earth having its doors closed. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. Brothers and sisters in Islam, this really has been you know, the point of many of your messages and the reason for this particular video. I want to talk about this, about the masajid being closed in light of your correspondences and you know, messages. No doubt, brothers and sisters in Islam, the believers are attached to the masajid, and when the masajid can no longer look after the needs of the believers in terms of the congregational prayer, and more importantly the Jumu'ah prayer, which should be done in congregation in the masajid, no doubt it is understandable why the ummah feels the pain that it feels. And inshallah, this is a sign of iman. Now, brothers and sisters in Islam, you know, I am not going to share my view about a specific masjid closure or a specific masjid that is refused to close in this particular video. And I've said it before and I will say it again. These are matters of jurisdiction. They are jurisdictive, meaning fiqh, Islamic fiqh, prevents me from weighing in on a particular decision and to share my view whether I agree with it or not of an imam or a board of a particular masjid in a particular place, because my view is irrelevant, right? It's jurisdictive. The relevant view is the view of the local, responsible, knowledgeable Islamic scholarship, right? Their view is the view that is important, and me sharing my view goes against fiqh, and quite frankly, it would only be a cause of drama, which the Sharia does not want us to create. In fact, I could be sinful if I was a means of creating unnecessary drama. So this is the first point, brothers and sisters in Islam, to those who are asking, my view isn't important. But moving on, in terms of weighing in with regards to the overall discussion, those who are pro and those who are against, we must understand, brothers and sisters in Islam, that both parties, right, both parties agree that from the objectives of the Sharia is the preservation of life. Both parties agree that, you know, if we have a circumstance where something good can be done, but by doing that good, a greater harm is going to come to be, then Islam tells us not to do that good. Leave that good to avert harm, because the Sharia, you know, has a higher precedence when it comes to averting harm than it has when it comes to attaining good, if that good will lead to a greater harm becoming an outcome. Both parties agree that if there's two harmful matters at your disposal, you have no other choice between doing this which is harmful and that which is harmful, then you should do the lesser harm so that you can avert the greater harm. Both parties agree to this, brothers and sisters in Islam. Both parties agree that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gifted the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam a unique gift, and that is the gift of the entire earth being pure and a place of prayer. There are exceptions, of course, which are in the books of fiqh, and this is not our place to discuss those exceptions. But in general, Allah has made the entire earth for us a place of prayer. He's purified it and made it a place of prayer for us, and this is specific to the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Both parties, brothers and sisters in Islam, they agree that closing the masjid is no big matter, right? Rather, it is a major, massive, catastrophic matter, right? I want to put it this way, and I put it this way deliberately. No one is belittling this, brothers and sisters in Islam, and I highlight this because in the correspondences that are going around, many are sort of losing trust in the Islamic scholarship and losing, you know, I would say to an extent, losing respect with their local imams or their local trustees. And this shouldn't happen, brothers and sisters in Islam. We shouldn't allow shaytan to help the coronavirus in its endeavor creating havoc across the globe. We need the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to get out of this difficult time that we are in. The last thing we want is to do that which blocks the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from reaching us, and that is by disuniting and disrespecting our scholars and speaking about them in we've used the word unprecedented, so let's say it in unprecedented ways. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we shouldn't do this. We should understand that this matter of keeping the masjid open and keeping the masjid closed is a matter of religious reasoning, personal Islamic reasoning. Those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed with the ability to look into the laws of Islam and the evidences of Islam and understand the implications and so on and so forth, they sit with these matters in light of real-time data and understanding the reality on the ground, and accordingly decisions are made. Now somebody might say, Sheikh, if this is the reality, then why do we have some masajid open and some masajid closed, and some scholars are writing on Twitter, and we understand from what they're writing on Twitter that they're speaking against the other scholar and so on and so forth. Brothers and sisters in Islam, they agree to all the things that I mentioned. The disagreement comes with regards to the micro matters that govern these values that I've shared, right? What constitutes a greater harm? What constitutes a minor harm? What constitutes a harm that will come about because of a benefit? This, it is these areas, brothers and sisters in Islam, these areas of contention where naturally difference of opinion will happen, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us with unique minds, with unique personalities. Sometimes when you look at a matter and you're trying to apply the Sharia, you might see it as a grey matter, and someone else will look at that matter and see it as a black matter or a white matter and won't understand why you see it as a grey matter. So these are from the matters where differences of opinion will come in, with nobody aiming to belittle Islam, to belittle the masajid, to disrespect the Sharia, to do wrong to their communities. Absolutely not, brothers and sisters in Islam. It's just a matter of human nature. And I highlight this so that we maintain respect with the scholars who say keep the masajid open, and with the scholars who say close the masajid. Okay? So, brothers and sisters in Islam, this is where we are at. Now, what is your situation? Some have said, I have a masjid that is open, I have a masjid that is closed, and I'm looking at the different discussions between the scholars, and they seem like, they can't agree and so on and so forth. So, why should the masjid, from the outset, the masjid is something open and the masjid is something accessible to the community, why don't we just go to the masjid? How should we make our decision? Now, in addressing this, and this is the main thrust of this particular video, in addressing this, brothers and sisters in Islam, what should you do? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in matters like this, istafti qalbak, you should ask your heart, the heart of a believer guides. But it shouldn't be, where you're asking your heart and your heart is guiding you without checks and balances. And in terms of the checks and balances, then the scholars of usul al-fiqh, they highlight a way for the masses to look at their religious responsibilities in light of scholars that have differed with regards to a matter. And they say that when there are two views, follow the view of the scholar that is known to be more knowledgeable. And if both scholars are at the same level of knowledge, then follow the view of the scholar that is known to be more righteous and more pious. And if both scholars are at the same level of piety, then follow the view of the scholar that matches the view of the majority of the scholars in the land. Okay, so there's a three-step approach. Follow the most knowledgeable. If they're both knowledgeable, follow the most pious. If they're both pious, then follow the view of the one whose view matches the view of the majority, in the land that you're in. So here we have clear guidelines of how to go about it. But understand well, brothers and sisters in Islam, that both scholars agree. Those who say keep the masajid open and those who say keep the masajid closed, they both agree that if you pray your salah at home, right, and if you pray dhuhr at home instead of jumu'ah, then you are not sinful. They both agreed to this, brothers and sisters in Islam, in light of the circumstance and situation we are in. No doubt we live at a time of rukhas, at a time of concessions. So both agree that if you pray dhuhr instead of jumu'ah, you won't be sinful. And both agree that if you pray by yourself at home instead of praying in congregation, you won't be sinful. Right? So alhamdulillah, they agree on much more than they disagree on. And this is where the focus should be with regards to you as an individual Muslim in your community and or in light of this difference of opinion that has come about with regards to this particular matter. So, you know, if you pray at home, you're not sinful. If you pray Dhuhr instead of Jumu'ah because you fear, you won't be sinful. And there's no need for you to feel guilty that I prayed Dhuhr, but that Masajid prayed Jumu'ah, for example. Because the Sharia allows you to pray at home if you fear, not just for your health, but even if you fear for your wealth, that if I go, I will lose my wealth. The Sharia says, don't go pray Dhuhr. It gives you, it relaxes the laws to facilitate your human nature, right? And it's from the nature of the human beings to have fear. Yes, the levels of fear are different, but I just want to highlight for each and everyone listening a way forward. Now, brothers and sisters in Islam, just one last thing, because we spoke about feeling guilty and so on and so forth. Understand that the scholars also agree, because this precedent comes from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that a person who regularly prayed their salah in the masjid, if they are prevented from praying their salah in the masjid due to circumstances, abnormal circumstances, unprecedented circumstances, then they will get the same rewards. They will get the same rewards. They will get the same rewards as they used to when they prayed in the masjid, when they prayed Jumu'ah in the masjid with congregation, and when they prayed the congregational prayers together in the masjid. They will get the same rewards as they used to, because right now it's not that they don't want to be there, but rather they've been prevented from being there. So I pray this resonates well with each and every one of us.